Prime Minister has announced the most drastic limits to our lives.
Stay at home and stay at least 2 metres away from people.
The NHS will not be able to cope to save lives.
Social distancing has become the new normal.
Cafes and shops are vacant.
They've obviously shut down about half the US economy.
Not only are stocks going down, gold is going down, credit's going down.
At this point, it's clear that we're going to have a recession that's more severe than the global financial crisis.
We are looking at other available options.
More and more people are buying and holding Bitcoin.
Bitcoin. Let's take a look at Bitcoin.
Some call this digital gold.
Everybody should probably have 1% of their assets in Bitcoin.
In terms of maximalism, how should we behave in order to, what's your take on this, just in general, or how can we avoid these?
Well, everyone is a scammer, according to someone. Andreas Antonopoulos is a scammer.
I know,
according
they call him
to,
a scammer.
According to Bitcoin maximalist, because he has written a book on Ethereum.
Mastering Ethereum, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's, Vitalik is obviously a scammer, because he built Ethereum. But then you have people calling Bitcoin maximalist scammers as well. Everyone is a scammer, so look, it doesn't mean anything in the space. Which is bad because there are real scammers as well. And when you call out a scammer that is a real scammer, you don't get any attention because everyone has been called a scammer. So I think it's bad that scam doesn't mean anything in this industry. But it's also how it is. And look, you can absolutely be maximalistic, but you just lose an opportunity. So why would you do that? It's like bankers thinking that that Bitcoin's gonna fail and they're being maximalistic to their banking ecosystem. So I think that unfortunately too many people are like that as well in Bitcoin. And to be honest, they're only hurting themselves because look, during the past few years, you would be way better off if you actually invested something in Ethereum or in EOS or in something else. Look, there you take more risk. And for newcomers, new people, it's better to be maximalist, actually, and to be maybe just in Bitcoin and Ethereum, and that's it. But if you stay like that and you learn more, you're just limiting yourself. Because look, there are many more opportunities outside of just Bitcoin and Ethereum. It's important to realize it. But you're also taking more risk. Because we've seen many exit scams, many ICOs that just run away. So at the end of the day, it's all about your risk tolerance and what you're looking for. But the history is clear that you would be better off if you actually invested a bit in Ethereum when it was early. So I don't get maximalism too much. Look, I understand that we've seen many scams and I get it from that perspective, but it is just too, it's sounding too much like bankers to me. That, hey, you know, if you are such a, I see many, you know, these experts on television saying that Bitcoin is a scam and they are this expert. So, but man, if you are such an expert, how could you have missed the asset that went up 9,000,000% over the last 10 years? I mean, what kind of expert are you if you've missed it? You've had 10 years. Even if you got in the last 5 years, you would already make thousands of percent. So not only you missed millions of percent, you also missed, and still you're telling me that Bitcoin is bad and a scam. And the same is with Bitcoin. Like, look, if you are such an amazing guru, how have you missed Ethereum's and Ethereum's rise as well from the ICO to now? So you got to be open-minded at the end of the day. But I get that you got to be protecting newcomers. And it's better for newcomers to have the mindset that, hey, Bitcoin and Ethereum and everything else is questionable until proven otherwise.
A lot of people say that the Bitcoin maxis usually see them as competition because they think everyone's trying to be money. But that sounds kind of like rewards, membership points, loyalty points, some sort of different model. Then it's not all money, right?
There are a bunch of Bitcoin maximalists and, you know, unfortunately for them, all they see is Bitcoin, decentralized money. And then there's a bunch of people who believe in experimentation. And for me, I know Bitcoin is working. I'm also looking to experiment and do cool shit using the blockchain.
That's what we want, cool shit doing the blockchain. You created this video the other day, which was about maximalism. And I will never forget one of the analogies, and I was really touched because you talked about how in politics, there's always a spectrum. You can choose between, you know, being liberal, extremely conservative, and religion also. We have extremists, and then you have the people who just don't have religions and stuff like that. But is maximalism close to that side, to the extreme right side, in terms of it's my way or the highway, or I'm not open enough to accept other projects, or is it a little bit different in your opinion?
Yeah, I think recently I compared the Bitcoin maximalists to Antifa.
Yeah, yeah.
And Antifa. They just like don't want people to even be able to have ideas in their head that doesn't conform to what they want the world to be. And like, that's not the world I want to live in. I want to live in a world with like a diversity of not only cryptocurrencies, but a diversity of ideas. And then people can argue and debate and sharpen those ideas, and we can figure out, you know, what the most effective ideas and thought processes in the world are to make the world a better place for all of us. But like, imagine if everybody had to think the exact same thing. How boring would the world be? And we'd never be moving humankind forward.
I was watching a video on Roger Ver the other day, and he was really emotional about how Bitcoin maximalists are almost like the extremist religious people who are not open and really fixed-minded and not open to anything else besides Bitcoin. How do you view them in generally speaking, these Bitcoin maximalists?
At the end of the day, everyone knows what Bitcoin is. No one, barely anyone knows what Litecoin is. Maybe some people know what Ripple is. So Bitcoin is really all that matters. But at the end of the day, it's about the success of the blockchain and cryptocurrency sphere for the mass adoption. So you have to broaden up a little bit. You don't have to invest in it. However, you have to accept that there are different ideas, smart contracts, DApp platforms. It's not just all about Bitcoin. So they have to calm down a little bit. And I don't often agree with Roger. However, I do agree with him a bit. And people say that crypto Twitter and the whole crypto space feels a bit like a religion, like a cult.
It does, yeah. You
know? And it does a little bit, you know, because you end up having conversations with people who don't understand the space, and you do sound a little bit insane to them because they're like, what are you even talking about? Like, because they don't understand the principles of money. And I'm not saying I do. It's only been 2 years I've been in the space. However, when you research a little bit, you realize that the money actually doesn't work. And the sooner people realize that, the better it'll be for them. And if it's going to be Bitcoin, it's going to be the solution, then fantastic, you know, we're sorted. If it's going to be a different solution, whatever solution crypto brings out, it's what matters is that it works. It helps people, it improves people's in poverty life. And I think that's what people should really focus on, not what's going to be the best. It's a maxi sort of a behavior, and I'm against it.
I think the biggest threat for Bitcoin and open blockchains is fragmentation and ideological rigidity within the community. A lot of people feel that their view of what Bitcoin is the only correct view and are actively hostile towards people who hold different views about what it could be or is. They act as gatekeepers, actively discouraging people from adopting Bitcoin if they don't follow the same ideological patterns. So Balkanization, as we call it, and I grew up in the Balkans, so I know exactly what that's like, this kind of tribalism where there is only one true coin and there's only one true interpretation of what that coin means and one political ideology that comes with a bunch of other criteria that have nothing to do with currency, but are aligned with the politics of whoever is speaking at the time. And that should be the only true way. I think that's a dangerous pattern. And I think that pattern actually creates a lot of problems for the adoption of cryptocurrency because it turns people off who may see different values, different use cases, or come from different political social economic background. And if the first glimpse they have of cryptocurrency is you have to conform to this rigid political ideology with all of the baggage that comes with it, they're just going to walk away.
We have Bitcoin and we have shitcoins. Now, ICOs are a little bit different. To me, ICOs are unlicensed, unregistered, uncompliant, and illegal securities. Those are ICOs to me. But to me, shitcoins is pretty much anything. Litecoin, Ethereum, though Ethereum was also an ICO. Monero, for example. To me, they're considered shitcoins. Now, some of them were created with a malicious, fraudulent, scammy nature. And some of them were not created as a malicious, fraudulent nature, but that doesn't mean they're good projects. It doesn't mean they're good investments. So for example, I don't believe Litecoin was created maliciously for you know, a small group of people to get rich. I don't believe Monero was created maliciously for a few people to get rich. On the other hand, I believe Ethereum was created for a few people to get rich. So was Ripple, so was Dash, and so were pretty much anything created after 2012. So anything created in 2013 and beyond, by then, you already know you're creating this to get rich. Back when Charlie Lee launched Litecoin in 2011, back when Monero launched, I believe in 2012, maybe 2013. Back then, they were still thought of as science experiments. But after thinking and reflecting and actually understanding the ecosystem, it's pretty clear to many of us why Litecoin and Monero, they will never be Bitcoin.
I tried to wear multiple hats and to not be involved in war religions, in religion wars, yeah. Right? Because, I mean, and I'm trying to be objective and trying to serve as many communities as possible, because only in that way, we will keep growing, and we will continue to offer a better product. So, I mean, competition is still on one single blockchain, and for me, it's crazy, because it's the obvious thing is to be on multiple blockchains and serve as many communities as possible, right? The EOS has a big community, Ethereum has a big community, Tron has a big community, Liquid. So all these are communities that are worth serving, and they will bring additional value to your ecosystem. So why not?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So why hate on them when they're contributing to the space, right? It doesn't make any sense to have these religions.
We felt that was natural for us to become the liquidity center. There are so many new business opportunities around Tether that goes to a company that talk to us and say, well, we want to use Tether for remittances, to pay salaries, invoices. There are a lot of companies now that are paying electricity bills in Tether. There are companies that are offering loans in Tether in exchange for Bitcoin collateral. I mean, so businesses can grow using a stable value without giving up their commitment to long term to Bitcoin.
And in digital currency, I also agree there's a lot of shit coins out there. Obviously, I think Bitcoin is the one coin. Now, there's other ones where there's Litecoin, Ethereum, and so on. And there's like all the shit coins down the spectrum. So I don't want to get, it's like one, I hope that one app, bad apple, doesn't ruin the whole basket, right? Mm-hmm. But the point is that let's look at Bitcoin. Let's look at that as a digital currency. Can that play a role in the global economy going forward? And I think a lot of central bankers are afraid of it. They're vastly afraid. So they're all, you know, trying to checkmate this and not let Bitcoin take off.
And obviously, Bitcoin maximalists are huge these days, and the dominance in the market over 70%. A lot of people love Ethereum for introducing smart contracts and a virtual machine.
Yeah.
What is your take on Ethereum?
You know, I never got into Ethereum very early, so I admit I missed the wave. I own some Ethereum today, but to me, what's more interesting, even as a computer scientist, I've computer science degrees from Stanford University. And for me, the notion of virtual machine and all that, I think it's cool. But to me, what's more interesting is Bitcoin, is the economic notion that we can have digital money, a global asset class that's digital and truly, I do consider truly decentralized, and people can freely move it without permission and do it in a pseudo-anonymous way. So I think that's much, much more exciting than a computer hardcore problem about virtual machines and on the blockchain and stuff like that. So to be honest with you, I myself don't do any smart contracts. I don't issue any tokens. I'm not a fan of ICOs. I don't do anything like that. So I'm very much a hardcore Bitcoin maximalist, if you will.
I was speaking at an event just this weekend where there were a lot of maximalists. I have to say that taking a step back, we have to just remind ourselves that Bitcoin and some of these other altcoins, including ours, do very different things. They serve different purposes. And again, if we're going to build business logic into blockchain applications, then we need altcoins that, you know, do allow you, for example, to build smart contracts. So do I think in the next 30 years that there will be space for tens of thousands of different coins? No.
Of course not.
But I would say that trying to compare Bitcoin to an altcoin and asking if one or the other is going to win is a bit like comparing gold, a chunk of gold, as a commodity with a future or option.
Yeah.
Right? It's you're not comparing like with like.
Absolutely. I think that's a really good way to put it, because if Bitcoin was your personal bank account, you still need financial services. The entire banking industry is not just a bank account, or the financial industry is not just a bank account. So
It
makes a lot of sense to say, hey, these are apples, these are oranges. So would it be better to look at it as asset classes? So let's say if I wanted to invest in crypto, I want to invest in blockchain protocols like Zilliqa or other protocols that I like. And then this is the asset class for exchanges. They might be the New York Stock Exchange of crypto. Is that a more rational way of looking at it?
I think that's the exact way that an investor or a trader perhaps should look at these things. They're different asset classes.
You know, we have to get ourselves out of this competition or scarcity mindset. You know, we need to move away from that maximalism. I view crypto maximalism similarly to religious fundamentalism, right? And haven't we learned over thousands of years that isn't working for us? You know, it's open minds, open hearts. It's the, you know, willingness to agree to disagree, but to respect your beliefs. You know, and to allow you to have your beliefs. They may be different than mine. You know, my chain is better than your chain. My coin is better than your coin. My religion is better than your, that, again, I don't think that that's the answer. I think that we need to migrate into, you know, an abundance, you know, sort of mindset, you know, a co-opetition, right? Where we recognize that it's all innovation and you may end up delivering the solution that makes life better for all of us. And so I should be encouraging you to innovate. You know, you might be the key. You might bring the solution. I know we all want to say it's me, and I'm right, I'm right.
But capitalistic mindset.
Yeah.
Right, I'm better.
You know, conscious capitalism is where, you know, we need to go. Yeah. Well, I mean, but this is back to capitalism, socialism, communism, anarchy. They're all right in some way, but they're all wrong.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, capitalism creates an economic incentive, which motivates us to do things. But unbridled capitalism has, you know, operated under the assumption that we had unlimited resources, which we don't. And capitalism has gotten us this far, but it will ultimately destroy us if we continue to have unbridled capitalism. We have to have conscious capitalism. And this is where, you know, communism was a great idea in the sense that, okay, let's make sure that everyone's taken care of. But the problem is it didn't provide for any incentive, any motivation. Which, you know, this is, you know, back to an anarchy again, the same sort of idea that, you know, we should all be free. You know, there's great truths and wonderful concepts in all of them, you know, but they're all wrong in their own way. And what we need to find is, you know, that ultimate truth, which is probably an aggregation of all of these ideas.